be with you.
And also with you.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark chapter 1, commencing at the ninth verse.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Mark chapter 1, from verse 9. Not long afterwards, Jesus came from Nazareth in the province of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. As soon as Jesus came up out of the water, he saw heaven opening and the Spirit coming down on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my own dear Son, I am pleased with you." At once the Spirit made him go into the desert, where he stayed 40 days, being tempted by Satan. Wild animals were there also, but angels came and helped him. After Jesus had been put in prison, after John had been put in prison, Jesus went to Galilee and preached the good news from God. "The right time has come," he said, "and the kingdom of God is near. Turn away from your sins and believe the good news." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So once again, welcome everyone, especially those who are watching this on the screen as well. This Lent, we are studying maturity in Christ using the Psalms. On Ash Wednesday, we looked at the first part, which is faithfulness always, which was recorded and distributed in the usual way. And I hope that many of you were able to catch up and watch that video recording. We couldn't meet in church on the day because of the unexpected lockdown, as we could not meet last Sunday as well. Today, the first Sunday in Lent, the second part of the series, and it's about learning the ways of the Lord and using Psalm 25 for today's exploration. So if you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Psalm 25 as we look at this reading for today. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for making yourself known to us and showing the way of salvation through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you now to teach and encourage us through your word, so that we may faithfully serve you for the glory of our risen Lord. Amen. One thing I've learned in my lifetime, is that it is not easy to learn about people. I'm sure many of you would agree to that proposition. It is not easy to learn about people or about their ways. It takes time, and sometimes it takes longer for different people. We think we know all that is to know about a person, but every day brings out something different, something unique, which implies the necessity of having a relationship with them to understand and to learn their ways. After bringing their first baby home from the hospital, the wife suggested to her husband that he try his hand at changing diapers. And the husband responded, "I am busy. I'll do the next time." The next time the baby was wet. And she asked if he was ready to learn how to change diapers. He gave her a puzzled look, then said, "Finally, I didn't mean the next diaper, I meant the next baby." Both of them had much to learn about each other. Psalm 25, if you have in front of you, reveals that David did not just know about God. This wasn't second-hand knowledge based on what he had heard from someone else or what he had seen outside of him. David knew God very well. He knew him intimately from personal experience and after what has happened over some time. And from that relationship, David learned the Lord's ways. So what did David learn about God and God's ways. Let us look at verses 1 to 3 in Psalm 25, where he wrote, In you, Lord, my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one hopes in you who will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. That's the NIV translation. In the NRSV translation, it says, to you, O Lord, I lift my soul. David learned that God is one who could be trusted completely. So much so, he surrenders his soul to him in absolute trust. That is essential if one is to learn the Lord's ways. Trusting in God is the theme that holds this psalm together. It is from that absolute trust that David is willing to or able to surrender his soul, that is and all that is, in confident and certain hope that he will never be put to shame. In that culture where publicly being shamed is the worst that could happen to a person, this realization of God's ways must have been a real eye-opener for David. That's the first thing. He learned the Lord's ways. The best way to learn the Lord's ways is to trust him. The second thing that he learned is that we turn to verses 4 to 5. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. The word way is actually a metaphor common in the Psalms, where the reader is invited not only to interpret the way, but also to walk in it. Show me your ways, O Lord. It is as if the road is saying, here I am, but do not just look at me, rather walk on over me towards the direction I am pointing, and let me bring you there. Show me your ways, Lord. Notice that even in learning the ways of the Lord, it is God who shows and teaches David the ways of him. God is always the teacher, the guide, the one who shows. It is more than theory, but includes practical aspects of life. Similarly for us today, for God to teach us his ways, show us his paths, and guide us in his truth, it requires a living, lifelong relationship with David, with God, similar to that which David had with the Lord. This theme of God will intentionally take steps to teach, to show, to guide people about his ways, continues later in this psalm. From verse 8 we read, good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful toward those who keep the demands of his covenant. God continues to instruct people, whoever we are, in his ways, even today. On our part, are we humble to listen to him, or are we proud, thinking that our ways are superior to God's ways? We know better. God's ways are many-sided, multifaceted, meaning that they are vast, they are unfathomable, and beyond our comprehension. In summing up God's ways, David informs us that God's ways are always loving to those who keep the expectations of the covenant. Even though the world may consider that the Lord's ways are unloving and perhaps even harsh from the world's perspective. The covenant that David refers to in Psalm 25 is the Old Covenant, aspects of which we have referred to many times in the Old Testament. The most recognizable aspect of the Old Covenant is the Ten Commandments. The new eternal covenant under whom we are is summed up in Jesus. which was launched by God during the baptism of Jesus in today's gospel reading. Mark chapter 1, verse 11. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." The writer to the Hebrews explains this new and eternal covenant once again in Jesus in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20. "Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant, brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equipped with everything good and doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." Some of us here present would be glad to note that at this point, exploring and understanding the Old and New Covenant is not for today. It will cover many weeks, maybe even months, to understand the full aspect, the depth and width of the Old and New Covenants. So you turn back to the theme for today. What does it mean to learn the Lord's ways? A grandmother told a granddaughter, "Tomorrow we are going to Sunday school." "I don't like Sunday school," said the granddaughter. "We need to learn more about God," replied the grandmother. The granddaughter said, "I learned about him last week." The grandmother said, "I've been going to church all my life and I haven't learned enough." The granddaughter replied, "Well, maybe you weren't paying attention." The elements of truth in that illustration. Ideally, learning the Lord's ways begins when one is young. But that does not mean learning cannot begin or continue when one is older. I began further engineering studies at a late age. My theological studies also at a much later age. It is never too late to learn the Lord's ways. It is of course helpful to learn with others, particularly with your own peer group in the journey. It is useful to remember learning the Lord's ways, just like any other learning process never stops. Are you still learning the Lord's ways, or have you stopped? The moment we think, "I have learned enough," we are on a journey to forget what has been learned. You are then on a downhill trend. However, taking a step back, the essential part for learning the Lord's ways is that there must be an ongoing relationship with the Lord, just like in the case of David. Do we have a strong, intimate, ongoing relationship with the Lord? If that isn't present, we only learn about the Lord. It is just theoretical knowledge. And frankly, that is of no use to us, those who want to grow and mature in Christ as his disciple. David obviously had this strong, intimate, ongoing relationship with the Lord, beginning from a young age. And because of this, he learned to trust the Lord in every aspect of his life. Remember the time he was willing to confront Goliath face to face, even though he wasn't battle trained, he wasn't battle hardened. David also learned that ultimately it is the Lord who taught, showed, and guided him as he learned God's ways. May this Lenten season revive within us the deep desire to learn the Lord's ways and mature in Christ as the Lord teaches, shows, and guides us. As David wrote in Psalm 25, "Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long." Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, as David prayed, I pray that you will continually show us your ways. Teach us your paths. Guide us in your truth, as you are our Savior, and our hope is always in you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.